Welcome to another episode of FFBR Live. I'm your host, Matt Crane, station manager of Final Fight Bible Radio. And today is Friday, November 10th, 2023. And I have another special guest on the show today. And this special guest is no stranger to Final Fight Bible Radio. You might know him from our regularly broadcasted program, The Offensive Christian. Today, my special guest is the one and only Robert Militello. So stay tuned. Now, just in by way of a few announcements before we get started for today, once again, I want to let everybody know that we do have the seasonal holiday stream now available through FFBR Premium. And you may have noticed on the regular Final Fight Bible Radio stream, there's a few more songs pertaining to thankfulness. There's some listener recordings of things that listeners have called in and left a message and said that they're thankful for. We're trying to really focus on thanksgiving and giving praise and glory and thanksgiving to God during these next couple weeks leading up to Thanksgiving. And so if you have FFBR Premium and you go to the FFBR Premium page, you will find a stream, a holiday stream, that basically right now is just playing Thanksgiving music just all day, every day. And so you can check that out. And FFBR Premium, we want to say thank you to this audience. So normally you get 7 days free and then it's as a free trial and then it's $5 a month after that. Right now we're doing a promo of 30 days free. You get 1 month free to try it out. And then if you want to continue, it's $5 a month after that. There's no contract. There's no cancellation fees or anything like that. Basically, the $5 a month is a help and blessing and help support this radio ministry and all the various things we're trying to do through Final Fight Bible Radio. But you also get the benefit of being able to listen to that holiday stream in addition to five other streams, a teaching-only stream, a preaching-only stream, a kids stream, a music-only stream, and a scripture stream. Plus, you get access to the audiobooks that we have available through FFBR Premium and the FFBR Live archive with all these previous FFBR episodes that we've been doing this year. They're all there. You can go back and listen to those at any time you want. And when after Thanksgiving, we're going to start segueing into Christmas music. And so we're going to be playing Bible-based Christmas music, not Santa Claus is Coming to Town or any of that stuff. We're going to be playing Bible-themed Christmas type music. And of course, I fully understand that Jesus was not born in a cave on December 25th or anything like that. We understand that as Bible believers. Nevertheless, everybody recognizes this time of year as the time of year that we think about and recognize and celebrate the fact that God loved us so much that he sent his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. So be looking forward to that. And also, as far as the Thanksgiving things go, I do have a recorder button set up on the app or our website where I would encourage you to record a short, you know, 15, 30 second, 1 minute clip of something that you're thankful for. And Lord willing, by the grace of God, I will try to take those recordings and get them onto the station. A number of you have already sent in some thankfulness recordings, and I am thankful for that. And I will be getting those on the station shortly. All right. And I also want to say thank you to this listening audience for your years of listenership and support. We certainly couldn't be here without the Lord using you to support this ministry. And there's a number of you that do support us monthly. And just so you know, if you support Final Fight Bible Radio or any of our foreign stations, be it the German station, the Dutch, the Greek, the Russian, the Korean, the Thai, the Pashto, or the Spanish station, or the Liberia FM station, any of those stations, you support them or Final Fight Bible Radio for $25 a month or more, you get a free subscription to FFBR Premium, just as a thank you. So we appreciate you. All right. I am making progress on these app updates. I'm having to go through every single one of our foreign apps and basically rebuild the app to some extent in order to conform to the Google Play Store's policies that are constantly changing. And so I've had to devote a lot of time to that recently, but it's going well. And we're making progress, and I had to do the FFBR mobile app recently. So for those of you that tried to tune into Premium, yesterday in the morning hours, you might have noticed that the app looked a little different. We didn't have the premium button there. And all of it was just part had to do with all these updates that we have to do for the app. So everything's back to normal now. And we appreciate your prayers and your support for this ministry. And I am going to be doing some relocation next week or over the next couple of weeks. The Lord has provided us a location that is going to be better suited for both my family and the ministry of Final Five Bible Radio. So I'm going to be on top of all the other busyness going on at this time of year. I'm also moving, and I'm moving the radio station and everything associated with it to this new location. So next week, we're going to have another special guest, but he is going to be hosting the FFBR Live on my behalf. So that's all I'll say about that. So be sure to tune in and listen to that. That'll be good. And before we get too much farther, we have to bring up our missionary of the week, if you will. And this is our missionary friend in Sicily. All right. And so his wife is now 5 months along. She is pregnant and everything's going well so far. He says recently their church had a handful of visitors and they were able to lead one Italian woman to Christ. And he says that she was raised Catholic and Pentecostal and was thoroughly confused, but she's been learning the word of God and growing in Christ. And he asks for his supporters and for Christians to pray for her growth and also for the salvation of her Catholic husband. And he said last week they had thieves actually break into their property and steal all the microphones, the mixer, the harp, and a whole bunch of equipment from their church. And he says that the next day they went to the marketplace where that is typically known for selling stolen goods. And sure enough, there was the harp that had been stolen. Yeah. So they called the police and the police were able to get that harp back and return it to them. But they are still missing a number of things. So be praying for them that they could get all that stuff back. As everybody knows, that stuff is not cheap. And he also asked prayer for the brothers there for wisdom and boldness. They're going out street preaching and he's trying to get some of the Italian Christians there to street preach with him. And he says there is one brother that street preached with him. And it was a blessing to see the native people there preach to their own people in their own language. And so he says, pray that the Lord will bring him faithful men. And he says the Italian culture looks at church as a place for weddings or funerals. So even after folks accept Christ, it's extremely hard for them to break from culture and attend regularly. So be praying for that missionary. Of course, if you want to support him or any of the other missionaries, you can do so through Final Five Bible Radio. 100% of what we receive goes to the missionaries. We don't take any off the top. We just try to be a conduit for your mission's support. Of course, you can send it to the mission boards. We don't care. It's just if it's convenient and you've got the app, you're already listening to Final Five Bible Radio and great preaching and teaching, and the Lord puts it on your heart to give to one of these missionaries, you can do it just right there. We try to make things convenient and simplistic for people. This missionary is having a sunny Sicily gospel week later on in May 7th to May 14th, 2024. And there's more information on that you can get either through Final Five Bible Radio. You could shoot me an email and I'll forward you that information if you want to be a part of that missions blitz that week. They're inviting people to come join them to pass out tracts, street preach, hold evangelistic meetings in Sicily next year, which sounds like it would be amazing. So if that's something you want to be a part of, you can get a hold of him or you can get a hold of Final Fight and I'll put you in touch with them. All right, so without further ado, let's start getting into what we're going to be talking about today. And as I said, my special guest is Brother Robert Militello, and he's going to be bringing us a few things from the Word of God. He always has something very interesting to say. He's always got some. He's a student of the Word of God. He loves the Word of God, and even though he's in his 70s, he is still studying and seeking for truth and light from the Word of God, and I love that. And so the Lord's been showing him some things, and he's got some things in regards to this Israel-Hamas war that's taking place right now, and some things that the Word of God has to say about it, and not just that, some very interesting things in regards to the timing of this Hamas attack. And just to segue us into this conversation, before we go to break, I'm just going to fill everybody in on what happened on October 7th. All right, so this is from the American Jewish Committee. This is just a real brief information piece, but At 6:30 a.m. on October 7th, Hamas, the Iran-backed terror group controlling Gaza, launched an unprovoked and vicious surprise attack on over 20 communities in Israel, using rockets, paragliders, boats, motorcycles, other vehicles, and whatever other means they could. Terrorists infiltrated the Jewish state and murdered more than 1,400 innocent people, including 30 Americans, injured over 5,400 people, and took over 240 hostages into Gaza. So with that, we're going to go to break. And when we come back, we're going to get into this Bible study and conversation with Robert Militello. Stay tuned.
Last night I lay asleeping, there came a dream so fair. I stood in old Jerusalem beside the temple there. I heard the children singing, and ever as they sang, methought the voice of angels from heaven in answer rang. Methought the voice of angels from heaven in answer rang. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, lift up your gates and sing. Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna to your King. And then methought my dream was changed, the streets no longer ran. Hushed were the glad hosannas, the little children sang. The sun grew dark with mystery, the moon was cold and chill, as the shadow of a cross arose upon a lonely hill. As the shadow of a cross arose upon a lonely hill. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, hark how the angels sing. Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna to your King. And once again the scene was changed, new earth there seemed to be. I saw the holy city beside the tideless sea. The light of God was on its streets, the gates were open wide, and all who would might enter, and no one was denied. No need. It was the new Jerusalem that would not pass away. It was the new Jerusalem that would not pass away. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, sing for the night is over.
Well, thanks for listening to FFBR Live. As a reminder, our chat room is open. So if you want to weigh in on the conversation today with Brother Robert Militello, or if you have any questions in regards to any of the things that we're talking about, please feel free to post a chat in the chat room, and I will communicate that throughout today's episode. So, Brother Robert Militello, thank you for joining the broadcast today. I appreciate the time. And can you hear me loud and clear?
Yes, I do. Loud and clear.
Yeah. All right. Excellent. I can hear you loud and clear. So go ahead and take it away. Go ahead and tell us what you got for us today.
Well, I want to tell God's people that with Israel and the Lord, there's never a coincidence. His timing is perfect. Israel is, in a way, God's wristwatch, you might say. And this surprise attack by Hamas, it'll be 5 weeks tomorrow, Saturday, was timed by the Lord. Now, what do I mean by that? Well, it happened that evening, Friday evening, which was also the beginning of a Sabbath, was a very important holiday that most Christians don't know about. It's the eighth day of the Feast of Tabernacles. The Feast of Tabernacles runs 7 days. Then on the eighth day, the Bible in Numbers calls for a solemn assembly. And you'll find that in Numbers. And it's unlike any other special holiday that the Jews have or festivals. This is a special thing because on all the others, the Feast of Unleavened Bread, if you find Numbers 28, 18, it talks about having a holy convocation on the first day. And also on the seventh day of Passover, a holy convocation. Same thing on the Feast of First Fruits. Same thing in the Feast of Trumpets. And the Feast of Tabernacles also, the first day is a holy convocation. But the eighth day, and if you look at Numbers 29:35, it says, on the eighth day, ye shall have a solemn assembly. Ye shall do no servile work. Now, this is really amazing. Here's the only feast that runs 8 days. Now, the Jews use the phrase Simchat Torah. That's the name of the holiday that they celebrate. And I knew it back in Brooklyn, living with Jews. Simchat Torah means rejoicing in the law, the Torah, rejoicing in the law. It's a great day for them. They open up the ark where they have all the scrolls. They take out the scrolls that evening, all of them, and they start dancing and carrying on and singing. And the joy is unbelievable, somewhat like the Feast of Esther, but probably even more joy than that. And that evening, 1,500 Hamas fighters, terrorists, broke in past Gaza, the security fence. And right at that time, when the synagogues were opening with prayer and praise and singing, the Lord had a great tragedy come upon his people. It's as if he just smashed down on their joy. And there was a music festival going on in the Negev Desert, not far from where they broke through in Gaza. And you know that children and women, and there was murder, wholesale murder and terror, such as the Jews haven't experienced since the Holocaust. Now, this is no accident. God allowed it to happen. And I'm wondering, why such a day of rejoicing and joy with such a tragedy just paralyzed the nation of Israel like it did? And it reminded me of the towers when they went down that morning. It was a beautiful morning in New York, and bang, out of the clear blue. Now, the Lord does that. He breaks in on parties and surprises. So while they were dancing and singing in the desert, especially the young people, they were going to be terrorized and killed, many of them, in just a few hours.
Yeah, and now, I'll throw in there, too, just for the sake of the audience that might be listening, mm-hmm. You know, when you say that God allowed this to happen, or God maybe did this, some listeners might think, oh, well, surely God had nothing to do with that Hamas attack. There's no way that God had anything to do with that. But the Bible says in Amos 3:6, shall there be evil in a city, or trouble or distress or disaster in a city, and the Lord hath not done it? Question mark. Yeah. Yeah. So the implied answer is ultimately the Lord is aware and allows for these type of things to happen in this Hamas attack. The timing is really interesting. The fact that the Jews are still God's people, even though they are apostate, you know, but they are still beloved for the Father's sake, according to the New Testament. So absolutely, God was fully aware of what happened, even if the Israeli Defense Forces were aware or not aware. That is always an interesting controversy right now. But God was most certainly aware of what happened. Yes. And the Bible says, you know, if there shall there be evil in the city, and the Lord hath not done it. But go ahead, continue.
Well, it's the way the Lord operates with the people that have fallen away from him. He sends them surprises, and this was a big surprise. I was just reading in the Times of Israel the other morning, a woman named Schwartz Altshuler said, Israel's disastrous love affair with military technology has given it a false sense of security. Mm. Even to the point where those that enlist in the service would rather, or they enlist in technological units rather than combat units. Now, we know in the scripture that safety is of the Lord. Safety is of the Lord. There was a lesson here to be taught. And if anybody's following things that go on in Israel, and I have for years, what's happened the last 20, 30 years? The Israeli technology sector has boomed. Israel has become very dependent on its devices, its technological devices, and it failed them. These Hamas people sneaked in that night, Friday night, and the Israeli observation posts were knocked down. And this woman in her article claims that the government in Israel felt very secure about the Gaza border because of all the cameras and electronic equipment and the sensors. Well, safety is of the Lord. And what happened there is what the Lord did in New York. All your money that's spent on all these security devices didn't amount to a hill of beans. It's just like the Lord saying, "Poof." It's amazing this is why the security that is, they have a love affair with their military technology. Netanyahu and the government, and even before him, boasted about the efficiency of the Israeli Defense Force and how they could repel any attack and how they've got the latest equipment that even the Arabs want to buy it from them. Yeah, I know all of that. I know all of that. And I followed that for years, and they do have tremendous equipment, but it failed. When the Hamas terrorists broke in, it took 3 hours or more for the IDF, the Israeli Defense Force, to respond. And all this mayhem was going on and murder. Now, the Lord allowed it. Yes, I create evil. He says it in the scripture. He allowed it. And to me, it was the timing of Simchat Torah, a day when they dance and sing and cry and carry on, a day of rejoicing, rejoicing in the Torah. By the way, on that holiday, they start a new cycle of reading the Torah. They begin again with Genesis 1:1. They end it in Deuteronomy. And the Lord is well aware of that. I mean, he attended these feasts. If you go back to John, you'll see in the gospel how clearly the Lord, on that last day of the Feast of Tabernacles, it's called Hoshana Rabbah. That's the name the Jews give to the last day. If you look at John 7, chapter 7, beginning in verse 37. Now, leading up to this, you had a lot of anger and contention between Jesus and the Jews, the leaders in the temple. Actually, the chapter starts off with Jesus' own brothers goading him. You know, go up to the feast, go up to the feast. And it says in verse 5, chapter 7, for neither did his brethren believe in him. And they knew he would be in danger, but they wanted him to go up to the feast anyway and show himself. Would you believe that? His own family. Would you believe that? He says in verse 8, go ye up into the feast. I go not up yet unto this feast, for my time is not yet full come. This is the Feast of Tabernacles. He does show up in the middle of the feast at around the third day. But here on the last day, which again, the Jews call Hoshana Rabbah, it's a great day of praise. He cries out. It says in verse 37, in the last day, the great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried, saying, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. He that believeth on me, even though this, as the scripture hath said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. He cried out with such a passion, but you have to know why. And if you look up the Jewish customs in the Second Temple period, Alfred Edersheim, his book, Life and Times of Jesus the Messiah, was very thorough on this. They had on that day of Simchat, the last day of Tabernacles, the high priest would take a pitcher of water, a pitcher of water out of the pool of Siloam. And that's where, remember, he couldn't get in the pool by the time the angel got in there. Okay, he takes a pitcher of water, and there's a procession led by the high priest and others to the temple. And he pours out in the altar a water libation. Now, why is this? Simchat Torah and the prayers that went on at that time were for the latter rain. You see, it was a feast also for the prayers for water. The Jews wanted water. They had just finished through the dry season, and they were thirsty. Remember Psalm 42:1, as the heart, H-A-R-T, passed. As the heart panteth after the water brooks, so panteth my soul after thee, O God. My soul thirsteth for God, for the living God. When shall I come and appear before God? And you read the same thing in Isaiah about the wells of salvation. That's the reference. That's what Jesus, he's talking to the crowd here. And there's been a lot of arguing among the, if you read that whole chapter, some believed in him, some didn't. The authorities were looking to take him that night, arrest him and kill him. They couldn't do it. It wasn't the right time. But water was a big thing. And here's the Lord's, and this is the Feast of Tabernacles, where God is tabernacling with his people. And he's crying out, if you thirst, look at me, come to me. This, in all the scriptures that I've read, this shows me the passion that Jesus has for his people, that love. It says in four places in the scripture that they're the apple of his eye. The apple of his eye. You'll find that, let me see, in four places. It starts off with the apple of the eye, Deuteronomy 32:10, Psalm 17:8, Lamentations 2:18, Zechariah 2:18 also. Israel is the apple of his eye. We, as Gentiles in the church age, we cannot understand, really, the passionate love between God and his people, God the Father. We cannot. It's so intense. You think of a jealous husband or a husband who the wife turned out to be unfaithful and left him. And he's crying for her to come back. If you're thirsty, come on. You remember in just a few chapters before John 4, the woman at the well, the Samaritan woman. And he's telling her, if you knew the water I had, you would ask of me a drink. I've got water that you're never going to thirst again. And this is why he's crying out this way. You're thirsty. You're thinking about water. You're hoping this new season, the rainy season, is going to be prosperous and everything. I'm the one you need. I'm here. And I've already performed all these miracles. And it's, to me, it's a cry from a man that's looking at a wife that left him. She went off with other lovers, Babylon, Assyria, and all the other. And he's crying to her, I have what you need. You're not going to find anything apart from me. I have what you need. I am your husband. And when I see Israel today talking about how great the military is and their security services, the Mossad and the Shin Bet, and they have spies everywhere and they know what's going on, it all fell apart. Because the scripture says safety is of the Lord. That's the Lord again saying, peekaboo, here I am. You need me. Your technology is not going to save you. And boy, what a lesson Israel has had to learn. And I told that to Christians that asked me. I said, that was a judgment. And it was a judgment on a day which would be set aside for rejoicing and dancing and carrying on singing. And he turns it into a day of mourning, a day of fear, a day of panic that Israel, the Jews, haven't known, I guess, since the Holocaust.
Yeah,
so the state of Israel is in trouble.
That is really interesting how that Hamas attack did occur on that day that we find there in Numbers, and also this day that we find mentioned here in John 37. So it really is remarkable that this day is throughout the Bible, and then we see this really significant attack, which has turned into a very significant war here in the land of Israel in the Middle East. I mean, the last time they had a war like this was, you know, what, 30 years ago or whatever, in the Yom Kippur War, if I'm not mistaken. And then this particular war, this isn't some 6-day war. I think we're going on like day 20 plus. So what we'll go ahead and do here is we'll take a break, and I'll give you a moment to collect your thoughts. We'll give the audience a break, and then we'll come back right after this song with more information from Brother Robert Militello in regards to this attack against Israel and this Feast of Tabernacles, Sukkot. We'll be back.
Lord,
right, we're back, and Robert Militello is my guest. Brother Militello, go ahead and continue where we left off. You were talking about Jesus crying out at this feast and it being a time of celebration and this Hamas attack falling right on the heels of that. Go ahead and continue.
You got to know the Jews have a passion for their holidays, their feast days, and this is the big one. The big Megillah is that crying out on the last day of Sukkot, which is Hoshana Rabbah, which means the great salvation in Hebrew. Now, in Israel, the eighth day is called Shemini Atzeret. And why they have a feast on the eighth day? Well, if I read sometimes the Talmud and various stories from the rabbis and the teachers. And here's one that grabbed me. It said it's like a king with his sons, and the Lord comes to visit. And for 7 days, they're feasting and carrying on and having the greatest time and fellowship that you can imagine. And then it's time to leave. The 7 days are over. But the Lord is begged by those in attendance, please don't go. Please stay with us another day. Please don't leave. And he stays. And that's the significance behind the eighth day. Now, I can't get into all the associations with seven and eight, but you know eight means new beginning. And after the 7 days are complete and this, the 1,000 years of the Lord reigning on earth, we go into the eighth day and time is no more. Now, why would the Lord leave? Well, after the millennium, the New Jerusalem comes down and the Lord's going to be with his people in New Jerusalem. And then the Lord gives up the kingdom and the new heaven and new earth to his Father. There's a whole big thing. I could talk about that for the next 4 hours. But there's a connection there on the eighth day, going into the eighth day. And they make it a special time of fellowship, begging the Lord, please don't leave us. And there's also an interesting thing in Numbers 28 about the amount of sacrifices, how many lambs and how many bullocks are sacrificed on all the other feast days. But on the eighth day, it's one lamb and one bullock. And I remember reading a rabbi saying that signifies the special relationship that God has with his people Israel. The other days of Sukkot, where many lambs are being sacrificed and bullocks, and that's for the nations, really. Sukkot really is a way of telling the nations, all right, you're going to be at peace now. You're going to be at, there's going to be joy and there's going to be happiness. But that special day, the eighth day, is a special day of fellowship where the Jews, you know, I mentioned the apple of his eye showing up four times. Now, it shows up one more time, but not in relation to Israel. It shows up for us. In Proverbs chapter 7, where it says, my son, keep my words and lay up my commandments with thee. Verse 2, keep my commandments and live, and my law as the apple of thine eye. My law. That explains the mezuzah, that little scroll that the Jews put on the side of their doors by their apartments. I used to see that in Brooklyn all the time. They'd go in and out, and they'd touch the scroll. And that explains the Jews that I knew dancing with the scrolls, and one of them telling me, this is our life. This is how we breathe. We breathe through every word of the Torah. And I says, wow, can I appreciate God's word like that? He tells me his law is the apple of thine eye. And Job said, I esteem the words of his mouth more than my necessary food. So what lights my eye is putting them on the words of God, his pure words. And the Jews here know that they are the apple of his eye. And again, this relationship between God the Father and his people Israel, which a lot of Christians don't, you know, spend much time in the Old Testament, don't really know much about this, but you can't disconnect the love of the Father for his people and these feast days. These feast days mean so much to them. And they were looked forward to. And that's why the Lord did not show up right away, because there was danger and his brothers were goading him, you know, go to the feast, go to the feast. But he came around the third day, it says. And then on the last day, he cries out like that. And he's the living water. And I thought of that passion of a man crying out to his people, and the connection between those feasts and Israel and the love for Israel that God the Father has. Here he is speaking, God the Father speaking to his nation through his son. Like Paul said in the last days, God speaks to us through his son. The prophets are all dead. They've been killed. Now it's the son crying out, I've got the water that you need. And he knows they're about to reject him. In fact, that night, they really would want to have killed him if they had the opportunity. But when I read this stuff, and especially that portion about loving them so much with such a passion, and then I see what happened 5 weeks ago and how the Lord allowed such terror to come on his people. Yes, the apple of his eye, to try and get their attention and say, you need me. Your military is not going to save you. Your technology, your good economy, it's not going to save you. You need me. But they're blind. They're blind. I hope through all of this, some in Israel come to realize, like New York City did with all the money they spent on security and anti-terrorist squad and the police department, everything. The planes got through and knocked down both towers, and 3,000 people lost their lives that morning. All the FBI, the CIA, all our security people failed to pick up the fact that there were Arabs training how to fly a plane and had an intention to fly into our buildings. Here we have the greatest security system, the so-called Gaza, the Gaza technology fence, and all this equipment there, the sensitivity devices all over the place. But 1,500 of these murderous assassins break through and terrorize little kids and their mothers and families. Would you believe it? And the IRF, which the IDF is sound asleep. What happened to them? Sound asleep. God put a deep sleep on them. Just said, you're going to go to sleep, and I'm going to allow your worst enemies, the latter-day Philistines, to come in and kill and torture and rape and behead you and leave you with such a sick feeling because you thought this could never happen again. You know, never again, never again, meaning World War II. We went like lambs to the slaughter. We went into the gas chambers. We went into the ovens. It'll never happen again. Well, it is going to happen again. This is a sign. This is a down payment on what's coming. It's going to come.
Yeah, you know, so it's amazing. Let me ask you this. I'm interested in your thoughts on this, and I know a lot of our audience is too. Based on, you know, your research and you know, your studies with all of this information over the years, with this particular war, what do you think? And I know you don't claim to be some kind of prophet or anything like that, but what is your opinion as to where this is headed? Like, where is the world going to be at a month from now? Is this war going to come to an end? Is Israel going to take over Gaza? What do you think is going to result from all
this?
There's
a couple of things that are going to happen. After the dust clears and the Israeli government and military gets rid of Hamas for the most part, they won't completely. I believe the government will go down. It'll go down. Really now in southern Israel, the people are talking about Mr. Security. That's what Netanyahu was known as. Mr. Security has failed us. Now, the same thing happened with the Yom Kippur War, which was a terrible surprise. Again, the feast day, the Yom Kippur War. Yeah. And Golda Meir had to resign. She had to take responsibility and resign. So they're going to get a new government, and it's going to be a type of government that desires peace more than any other government. They really want peace and safety, and who can blame them? What they've went through, they're going to want peace and safety in the worst way, and they're going to make a terrible mistake. But before that happens, my opinion is, there has to be a reckoning with Iran. And the reason I say that is the book of Esther coming before the book of Job. The book of Job is your great tribulation, 42 chapters, 42 months. Prior to that, the greatest threat to Israel, to the Jews everywhere, is out of Persia, which is Iran. Now, today, Iran has the spirit of Haman, the Agagite, Haman, who wanted to kill every single Jew in the empire because Mordecai wouldn't bow down and acknowledge him. So he had a hatred that was so fierce for the Jews, he almost convinced the king to have them all killed. So this threat has to be negated. And that's why the Arabs are kind of warming up to a degree, Saudi Arabia ready to have relations with Israel. The Arabs are afraid of Persia, of Iran. There's no love lost between the Arab nations and the nation of Persia. Iran is Muslim, but it's not Arab. It's not Arab. A lot of people don't know that. Yes, they're Muslim, but they're not Arab. And the enmity between them is like a cobra and a mongoose, or Turkey and Armenia. I mean, you look at these historic enmities that have existed over time between various nations. The Saudi Arabia is deathly afraid. And the Iran has these proxies, not only Hamas, but Hezbollah, the Yehudis or something in Yemen. They have other groups, and they're threatening Israel. At some point, this issue, this boil, must be lanced. It must be dealt with. And then there'll be some real security and peace in that area of the world for a while. I think this is where the Antichrist comes in. Now, will America take part in this thing? It's possible. We already have two carrier groups there, and we're beefing up our people there that are in Syria and other places, Iraq. We're getting fired upon by these Iranian proxies. So something's going to blow with that. Something's going to blow, but not after this, not until this Hamas situation. And by the way, in the first chapter of the book of Esther, the queen, Vashti, gets dismissed because of her rebellion and refusal to come to the king's banquet. She gets dismissed. She gets exiled. And in a way, Esther is a transition book. The church, in the form of Vashti, rebellious against her king, rebellious against the word of God, the King James Bible, with that woman's lip spirit, that rise of the women's spirit taking over many churches, he dismisses her. And that's, to me, that's a type of the rapture. That's like telling the body of Christ, come on home, it's over. The salt has lost its saltiness. You ain't really serving me the way I would like. Things aren't going well. The church is losing its edge. I'm taking you out, and I'm replacing you with a Jewish queen. That's really what's about to happen now. Wait, but people say, Brother Militello, where are we in the Bible? Well, you're in the first chapter of Esther. You're just waiting to be dismissed. There's always going to be a remnant. There's always going to be ministries that love the Lord, love his word, and try with all their might and heart to win souls, final fight in other ministries. There will always be a remnant. But by and large, the body of Christ, I remember Dr. Ruckman said 90% of God's people ain't worth shooting. He used to laugh. It's like the 10 lepers. One comes back and gives himself to the Lord, and where's the other nine? They took their salvation, and where did they go? They're back in the world for the most part. It's like Paul's letter, the second to Demas, having loved this present world. What? The present world hath forsaken me. Where is he? He's gone. He walked with me for a while. He's gone. And many are leaving. Many are giving up the fight. Many are just sitting in their chair looking at things. Oh, what's going to happen? What's this going to lead to? Well, get concerned, because you're going to be brought up to the judgment seat of Christ. And there's really nobody in the body of Christ should be surprised when this happens. I mean, this is the Lord's show. Oh, by the way, Israel had to learn this lesson about never again. If they thought the world had become more civil towards the Jews, they were in for a big mistake, a big, big mistake. Now, they thought that Israel would be their place of refuge, their place of safety. So Western Europe and the United States, well, actually the United Nations, carved out this little sliver of land and said, here, you have your own state now. You see, this is the place where all the Jews can go to and feel safe. Well, that fiction is over. That's gone. Why? Because the Bible says God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in time of trouble. Not this piece of land that you were given by the United Nations and the British mandate and the backing of the United States and all of that. That's not going to be your peace and security. Your peace is still the peace. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. It's the one you rejected. Without him, there is no peace. And now the nightmares have begun again among the Jews. What's going to happen next? We need peace and safety. When they shall say peace and safety, then cometh sudden destruction. They're going to make a deal with the devil. They have no choice. But first, Iran has to be dealt with in some way. And then the modern state of Israel, gee, I don't know. You know, it says in the scripture, 70 70 is the lifespan. And if by reason of strength, 10 more. I'm thinking of Israel in a way, a child not born by the will of God, but by the will of man, allowed by God to be born as a modern state in 1948. And when they were young, they were strong. The 1956 Suez War, later on the Six-Day War, they beat the pants off of Egypt and Syria. And then later on, they rallied back to the Yom Kippur War. When they were young, they were strong. But guess what? Israel celebrated its 75th anniversary last spring, last May. They're not young anymore. They're in that window period between 70 and 80. Mm-hmm. So the modern state of Israel is not God's doing. Yes, he allowed it, and the United Nations put that little land aside for them. They had a guilt trip. They felt, well, the Western countries, civilized as they were, look at Germany, a civilized nation, not like Hamas, not savages and butchers or a wild man like Ishmael's descendants, but a civilized nation had you in gas chambers and ovens. And you might, and so many Jewish psychologists believe this nonsense about human nature can be improved and all of that. They refuse to believe what their own book tells them about it's utterly depraved, and who can know it? I mean, the heart of man is desperately wicked. They just can't accept it. Maybe now they'll start looking, hey, you know, nothing has really changed. And unfortunately, Israel will again be the scapegoat. And but the Netanyahu government, not going to last too much longer after the smoke clears, and the pressure from the world will be increasing as far as a ceasefire and rebuild Gaza and all of that nonsense that you got to hear for the next Lord knows how long. But what a wake up call this was. What a rude awakening. It's like you're sleeping in the bed and somebody comes by with a bucket of ice water and pours it on your head. What a way to wake up. I mean, really scary. And these poor people, and that timing of that day, that day of joy, that day of happiness. And here they are, many young Israelis out in the desert attending that music festival, and they get killed and they're running for their lives. And the Lord purposely allowed it to happen on a day when they lift up their voices and they thank God for the Torah and they think about their special relationship with their God, the God of Israel, and bang-o. And here's something like this happening. I can imagine many Jews, just like when the temple was destroyed in 70 AD under Titus, many Jews saying, especially the rabbis that spend time looking in the books, what did we do to deserve this? What kind of message is this from the God of Israel, our hope, our glory? Why? Now, they don't know the Lord, so they're going to have to do it man's way. They're going to have to craft a peace or a security arrangement, and that's going to be with the Antichrist. They're going to have to beware the wolf in sheep's clothing. They're going to make a covenant with death and hell because they don't know the Lord. And if, when the rapture occurs, the United States is not going to be a world power like it is today. It's going to be nothing. So they're going to have to look for another bodyguard. And that's where the Antichrist comes in also. So we're living in tremendous times. And this should really be a wake up to Christians. If they're in the book, if they know anything about history or Israel or whatever, look at this and say, wow, we're going to leave soon. We can't be here much longer. But I'm not a prophet. I can't gauge the long-suffering of the Lord. I thought the Lord might be back already, but he is so long-suffering, and I thank God for that. And I thank God for those that are being witnessed to now and under conviction. God help them to get into the boat before that door closes and the boat sails away. But as far as picking days for surprise, well, remember Belshazzar's feast? Everybody happy, hey, singing and dancing and drinking from the vessel stolen from the temple. And all of a sudden, the hand comes out. You're finished. And the Titanic, that night, Saturday night, ready to pull into New York City the next morning, the singing, the dancing, and everybody happy. And then bang-o. And before you know it, they're playing Nearer My God to Thee. Things can turn from happiness and joy to utter horror. Horror. And that's what New York, and that spirit of arrogance, brother, that, like I saw in New York so many years, that nose up in the air. We're the Big Apple. All the big deals are made right here. This is us. We're special. And the Lord knocked them off that day and put a terror on that city like you can't believe. And now Israel has done the same thing. And I tell people, pride goeth before destruction, a haughty spirit before a fall. Look at that haughtiness of the Israeli government, their dependence upon technology and our military and our security forces and the Mossad and this. It all went up in smoke.
Yeah.
So I tell people, it's a judgment of God on them.
Yeah, and you're right. It's really incredible, the timing. And just as we look at scripture, there's just so many arrows that point to the fact that we are at the very end, I believe, of the church age. The world is getting primed and set up for what's to come, what we know is the Great Tribulation and the beginning of sorrows and all that stuff that Israel's going to go through. And we're pretty much out of time for today, but just to conclude with this scripture, I thought of as you were talking, there's this verse in Jeremiah chapter 16. And Jeremiah, as we know, he's preaching to the nation of Israel, the southern kingdom, right before the destruction of Nebuchadnezzar, which also, interestingly enough, is a type of the future destruction of the Antichrist during the Great Tribulation. Yeah. But it's interesting what Jeremiah preaches here. He says in Jeremiah 16, verse 9, he says, "For thus saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, behold, I, the Lord speaking, will cause to cease out of this place," speaking of Israel, "in your eyes and in your days, the voice of myrrh and the voice of gladness, the voice of the bridegroom and the voice of the bride. And it shall come to pass, when thou shalt show this people all these words, and they shall say unto thee, wherefore hath the Lord pronounced all this great evil against us? Or what is our iniquity? Or what is our sin that we have committed against the Lord our God?" And that's probably what a lot of Jews are asking today. Like, what did we do to deserve this? But then it says in verse 11, actually Jeremiah 16, 11, interestingly, it says, "Then shalt thou say unto them, because your fathers have forsaken me, saith the Lord, and have walked after other gods and have served them and worshiped them and have forsaken me and have not kept my law. And ye have done worse than your fathers. For behold, ye walk every one after the imagination of his evil heart, that they may not hearken unto me. Therefore will I cast you out of this land into a land that ye know not, neither ye nor your fathers. And there shall ye serve other gods day and night, where I will not show you favor." And that is a verse that applies directly doctrinally to the land of Israel in the times of Jeremiah and Nebuchadnezzar. But prophetically speaking, that same template fits with what we're witnessing now and what's going to happen. The Jews have forsaken the God of their fathers, and albeit they may not be worshiping idols, so to speak, but they did something even worse, and they crucified the Son of God, and they took Caesar over their Messiah. So, ladies and gentlemen, this is Brother Militello has been with us for the last hour. And if this information has been fascinating to you and you want to find out more, you want to learn more, you can listen to him virtually every day of the week on Final Fight Bible Radio. His lessons are about 15 minutes long, and they come on Monday through Thursday at 9 o'clock a.m. and 9 o'clock p.m. Pacific time. And then new recordings and newer episodes come on Saturdays and Sundays at 1 o'clock a.m. and 1 o'clock p.m. Pacific time. So you can catch his information there. Also, I believe there's a YouTube channel put together by Don Nesbitt, and he puts out all of Dr. Ruckman's material there. So you, or not Dr. Ruckman, Brother Militello's material there. So you can get a hold of more of Brother Militello's information and listen to more of these studies. But Brother Militello has been great. As always, I learned so much talking to you, and there are just so many things. As you said, we could go on for another 3 hours, but we are out of time. Thank you so much for taking the time to come on FFBR Live. We'll have you on again here in the near future for sure.
Thanks for having me, brother. Appreciate it. Thank you.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, thanks for tuning in. God bless you and have a good week.
I care not today what tomorrow may bring, if shadow or sunshine or rain. The Lord I know ruleth o'er everything, and all of my worry is vain. Living by faith,
yes, living by faith,
in Jesus above,
in Jesus above,
trusting, confiding in his great love,
in his great love,
from all harm
wandering arms. I'm living by faith. Storm clouds arise, obscuring the brightness of life. I'm never alarmed at the overcast skies. The Master looks on at the strife. Living by faith,
yes, living by faith.
In Jesus above,
in Jesus above.
Trusting, confiding in His great love. Living by faith. Earth some sweet day, our troubles will then all be o'er. The Master so gently will lead us away beyond that blessed heavenly shore. Living by faith,
yes, living by faith.
In Jesus above,
in Jesus above.
Trusting, confiding in His great love. Living by faith,
I'm living by faith,
and feel no alarm,
and feel no alarm.
Yes, I'm living by faith,
I'm living by faith,
and feel no alarm.